Thank you to Peter and the other organisers for inviting me along here today. It's really great to actually talk about my research about Queen's students at Queen's. It's the first time I've actually managed to talk about this research at Queen's. The title of my paper comes from a survey that students with the student newspaper at Queen's Garn did in January of 1975, and they had gone out and surveyed the kind of wider public about what they thought about students in Queen's. And one particular resident from Sandy Row, just simply known as Mrs. B, said, "Some aren't too bad, but they started all the trouble, you know. Brenda Devlin and all the civil writers went to Queen's. If I had my way, they would get no grants, not one of them." So in the discussions on the origins of the Troubles, very little attention is given to the student activism in the region in the 1960s. And the place of the university in creating a space where revolutionary and non-sectarian ideas could be shared and spread, I think, has been neglected. Bernadette Devlin argues that mainstream accounts of the civil rights movement in Northern Ireland have tended unfairly to sideline the student impact or represent it as an irrelevant irritant to the more sober, mature and minimalist activities of the Northern Ireland Civil Rights Association, or NICRA, and to the emerging political ideologies of newly energised nationalism. The tendency to prioritise this elitist interpretation of the civil rights movement in scholarly accounts of it, including the emphasis on the middle ground mobilisation of figures like John Hume or the Social Democratic and Labour Party or the SDLP, have diminished and underplayed the radical and populist origins of the student wing of the movement. By focusing on students specifically, we can examine those who came of age in radical left circles in 1960s Northern Ireland. These individuals immersed themselves in a new left landscape that grew up around Britain's anti-Vietnam War movement. They came to political consciousness in a left world on the point of transition, part of the Western European post-war generation that created a new democratic left project. The historiography on the student movement in Queen's is quite limited. Most historians deal in the main with people's democracy, and while there have been some attempts to look at this in a transnational perspective, such as Bob Purdy and Simon Prince, these examinations, I think, tend to be absorbed into a wider reading of the civil rights movement. The only book on people's democracy remains Paul Arthur's very thorough account of the movement, but this was published in 1974. Generational and socioeconomic changes at play during the time helped to explain why the revolts came along and why the university served as one of their starting points. However, an adequate account of student activism in Belfast in the 1960s must take seriously what students themselves said and did. There was a radical shift in the nature of student life on Queen's University Belfast campus, and the new student newspaper Garn is a testament, I think, to this change. By focusing on the archive of student newspapers, memoirs and published interviews with former student activists, this paper will explore the transformation from apathetic student to politically active demonstrator and examine the ways in which 1969 impacted on student activism in Northern Ireland and vice versa. Celia Hughes argues in her recently published monograph, Young Lives on the Left, the experiences at university provided many of the 1960s generation with a series of life-defining moments in their journeys towards radical selfhood. So, for example, student interactions with left groups on university campus, radical reading experiences, activism around Vietnam, free speech, the raising of fees for international students, etc. Significant social and emotional rites of passage, leaving home, new friendships, falling in love, contemplating adult life, coincided with social, cultural and political upheavals in a way that was always likely to intensify their impact and make them more memorable with time. I would suggest that universities, specifically Queen's Belfast, provided a liminal space for students in 1968 and 1969 and impacted their life course. The liminal stage involves one or all three kinds of separation: spatial, temporal, and social or moral. In Victor Turner's analysis, this is, quote, an instant of pure potentiality, when much of what has been bound by social structure is liberated and the transgression of norms and conventions becomes possible. Some students were aware of this possibility during the 1960s. Fred Taggart, the president of the New Ireland Forum in 1967, for example, outlined the contribution a university like Queen's could make in a society like Belfast. He argued, quote, "The community we live in is a very sick one. The university is a haven of moderate and intelligent thought compared to the world outside. This is where we come in. I believe the society, the New Ireland Forum, has a role to play as a forum of discussion and a means of expressing liberal views, which I think characterise the university." As early as 1964, Garn identified that Queen's Belfast was, quote, "undergoing a radical change, a change so subtle, so quiet, that very few students are aware of what is happening." This was largely due to the expanding nature of third level education in Britain. The full-time enrolments at Queen's increased by almost 73% between 1948-49 and 1963-64, with a full-time university population of 4,135 in 1964. As the only degree-granting university in Northern Ireland at the time, Queen's was the key to the Northern Irish establishment. The social background of incoming students in the 1960s diverged from that of earlier student generations. Before the education reforms of the 1940s, few working class families had both the money and the will to send their sons and daughters to the grammar schools that could prepare them for university. When Queen's became independent in 1908-09, Catholics accounted for fewer than 6% of the students going there. The 1947 Education Act had a levelling effect in Northern Ireland, enabling intelligent working class men and women to obtain a higher education at taxpayer expense. The first Catholic president of the Students' Representative Council was elected in 1955. While the debating societies in Queen's created vibrant environments for the politically minded in the late 1950s and early 1960s, namely Literific and the New Ireland Forum, Fred Taggart's aspirations were not the case by 1967. Student apathy was criticised and it was mourned. Bernadette Delvin, for example, commented on the anomaly in Belfast. She said, quote, "What made student politics all the more absurd at the time was that Queen's was basically a 9-to-6 university. None of us was the kind of independent 24 hours a day student that you get in college in England. You went home for tea. You were a student during the day, but your mother asked you where you were going at 8 o'clock at night." This is particularly noticeable when protests against the raising of fees for international students was organised, which attracted barely 50 students. One editorial in Garn remarked that, quote, "A traditional characteristic of the student is his willingness to espouse what he considers to be a worthy cause and fight with unceasing determination for that cause. The student has been to the fore in most movements for social and political reform. He has campaigned against injustice. He has stirred the public conscience. He has inspired and led revolutions, but he has not yet awakened in Ulster. Being an Ulsterman is an incurable disease. You never quite recover from the legacy of bigotry, hypocrisy, irrationality and lunacy comprising the Ulster mentality. As thousands of students in Britain organise marches of protest against the raising of fees for foreign students, the Queen's man sits back and considers the issue irrelevant. As his counterparts in Madrid are daily embroiled in riots, he tut-tuts the quality of union meals. The Queen's student is at best an impotent mugwump and at worst an uninquisitive bore." And I mean no offence to any students past and present at Queen's. It's not my quote. Although Queen's University was considered one of the most backward in the UK, Northern Ireland experiences similar upsurges in student militancy that were experienced in other European cities not long after this apathy was condemned. On the 9th of October 1968, 1,500 students gathered outside Queen's University to march to Belfast City Hall in protest against the events of the previous Saturday in Derry, the 5th of October. The students were loosely organised by a Joint Action Committee Against the Suppression of Liberties, a body representing almost all students' opinion except unionism. The protest demonstration on the 9th of October was met by counter demonstrations by Ian Paisley and rerouted. Students eventually staged a sit-down protest for 3 hours before returning to the university. But out of this frustration born from the march, a new organisation, the People's Democracy, was formed and for a time provided a home for more or less anybody at the university who disliked the status quo in Northern Ireland. On the 16th of October, a further march was organised, and this time 2,500 students reached the City Hall behind the PD banner. They included unionists this time, republicans, moderates, revolutionary socialists and anarchists. And never before or since have so many parties joined in one political protest in Northern Ireland. The politicisation of students could be seen by the fact that for the first time in many years, every position on the executive of the Student Representative Council of the Students' Union was contested. Not only that, but the National Union of Students Conference in Margate later that year in 1968 unanimously passed a motion supporting civil rights in Northern Ireland. As the civil rights movement began to get more and more contentious in the later months of 1968, the Prime Minister Terence O'Neill asked for a moratorium on marches so that he could introduce reforms. While the moderate NICRA agreed to this, PD decided to keep up the pressure to ensure that the movement's demands were met. They organised a long march from Belfast to Derry from the 1st to the 4th of January 1969, which was modelled on the Selma to Montgomery march. The march was particularly controversial as it proposed going through areas that were deemed to be unionist or loyalist, and it was predictably attacked just outside Derry at Burntollet, leading it to be known as the Burntollet March. For Burnt at Devlin, for example, the activism of the People's Democracy and particularly this experience transformed her understandings of socialism. She said, quote, it was the march to Derry, the People's Democracy Burntollet March that I was politically born. And quote, the vast majority of us didn't see ourselves as socialists. What we wanted was reasonable, basic rights, which we ought to have had. And all the government had to do was give them to us and we'd go away. That's certainly how I felt until January 1969. Then things changed. We educated ourselves into socialism. The Long March contributed to this, to our education. Celia Hughes also encounters this form of left enlightenment with members of the 1960s generation in England that she interviews, arguing that once young activists began entering universities in the mid to late 1960s, they discovered left circles at formative moments of self-making. Only a small number of students from that time have described themselves arriving at university with clearly defined left identities. And even then, these identities were reworked or consolidated as they became politically involved. The Burntollet March isolated People's Democracy from the broader civil rights movement to a certain extent. And as it was a result of this demonstration, which was considered provocative, that People's Democracy and students more generally were maligned in the wider community, where there was a widespread anti-student sentiment. The Vice-Chancellor ruled that People's Democracy was not allowed to use any university premises other than the Union Building for its meetings. This wasn't unusual. The president at UCD, Professor Hogan, threatened student activists with disciplinary action too. There were numerous attacks on the university throughout 1969, a petrol bomb attack on the music department, a gang attacked the Union Building, and the Department of Science Library was set on fire, indicating how strongly some people in Belfast felt about students. Those who attacked university premises no doubt identified students with People's Democracy and civil rights activists. One man from the Shankill Road commented that, quote, student means Bernadette Devlin to many on the Shankill, and she's the upstart of the whole apparatus. Others agreed, suggesting that, quote, they are there to study, not to demonstrate. And this wasn't only seen on the Shankill Road, this was also seen on the more middle-class Malone Road. The bitter feeling was just as apparent there. One resident said, quote, the privilege and honour of being at Queen's is being abused by present-day students. More discipline is needed. Students are making a bloody nuisance of themselves and they would destroy Queen's eventually. Another resident said, quote, the student image has deteriorated over the last year and Bernadette Devlin has not helped. Students are irresponsible in behaviour and dress and should be screened before admission. Why, only the other day I saw students sitting on the steps of the student union. Radical behaviour indeed. This kind of public reaction and maligning of students led to the university authorities taking more draconian actions. By October of 1969, there were restrictions on political meetings and only enrolled students and members of staff were permitted to attend meetings in the university. This was in a bid to prevent any outside elements influencing university movements and from having any sort of power among the student body. A meeting of the Committee of Deans and the Vice-Chancellor met before the autumn term of 1969 and asked student representatives to accept a three-month ban on People's Democracy. Members of the student executive refused and were told that a ban would be imposed on all political societies and given 24 hours to make a decision. But I think it's important to point out that the mobilisation of students around issues of civil rights led to greater involvement and critique of other topics, such as educational reform and the power structure within the university, indicating that 1968 and 1969 and student activism more widely should be considered more than just an aside to the civil rights movement and more than just people's democracy. It also connected students to wider global events that found resonance with what was going on in Belfast and indicated a recognition of the anti-imperialist rhetoric of the wider student movement. So, for example, there were protests against the South African Springbok rugby team coming to play against the Queen's University team in November of 1969. And in December, the Look at Biafra group held a hunger strike at Belfast City Hall during the Christmas break to raise awareness and funds. They also collected signatures for a petition calling on the British government to stop supplies of arms. In an editorial in March of 1972, these connections were recognised. It said, quote, "The one oasis in our history came with the birth of civil rights in 1968 and 1969. Everyone was astounded that we should have realised that we were part of a community which was considerably larger than fully duddy academics, revolutionary beards and 9 a.m. lectures. A byproduct of the civil rights campaign was new dynamism within the university itself as well as on the streets. We began to question the values of the education we were allegedly receiving. We demanded a fair say in the administration of the university. Within the union, all sorts of societies flourished as never before. In short, we became alive." However, the descent into violence by August of 1969 impacted on student activity. While an explosion-hearing society may have taken advantage of the increase in political unrest, a return to student apathy demonstrated by a shortage of candidates, a record low poll in the Student Representative Council elections in 1970, it seemed that violence took its toll. Turnout for the university constituency elections was put at 16%, compared with a turnout of over 50% in 1969. The number of candidates dropped sharply from 36 in 1969 to 26 in 1970. An article speculating on the decline of debate in Queen's in the same year looked to, quote, "the fundamental change in the attitudes of the Queen's student," and suggested that perhaps it is a reaction against the political activism at Queen's, which has been in existence for the last few years. In an editorial in 1971, it was noted that, quote, "the existence of a university side by side with a situation as exists in Belfast at the present moment is an anomaly, mainly because we as students are told to behave ourselves. The definition, it seems, of behaving ourselves is the perpetuation of social and political blindness. That the university should exist without some sort of electric energy beneath its academic surface is the desire of a narrow-minded few." By February of 1973, student apathy was once again a key feature of Garan, and again, suggestions for why this was so pointed to the political situation that existed in Belfast. One editorial remarked that, quote, "certainly the impression is that students just don't care anymore. Why is the big question? What springs to mind is that any student who sticks his head up from the waves of apathy could find it blasted off. Another factor is that students are fed up with politics anyway. The nightly TV debates soon exhaust the drawing power of the local political hacks. The university is hampered by parochialism. People are scared to say anything in tutorials, debates, or anywhere else. The socialisation techniques of Northern Ireland's educational system seem to have successfully stifled discussion, making it an idea still born." I could go on and say loads of things about how the kind of descent into violence, the introduction of internment, Bloody Sunday, etc., impacted and how students reacted to that at the university. And there's loads of things I think to say, oftentimes quite contradictory, but very, very interesting. It's beyond the scope of a 20-minute paper. But to conclude, I'll say three kind of things. I think we need to look beyond student activism we need to look beyond the fact that student activism might have started in 1968 and 1969 around the issue of civil rights. I think instead what you see by looking at the student newspaper is that there was a quiet movement by committed activists setting the scene for these pivotal years from as early as 1962 and 1963. The second thing that I think we need to question is this question that was put in the editorial in 1973. Why do we see this return of apathy? So why, after that kind of activism of that 68 cohort, what happens? And it's not just the violence, because there's violence in other universities. So you look at, you know, Germany and Italy and parts of America, and you don't see that quick return to apathy quite as quickly. So what happens in Northern Ireland? Where does that 68 cohort go, and why aren't they replaced by another cohort who are just as active? And finally, I think to answer those questions, we need to have a longitudinal study of the 68 cohort. What we need to try and understand is what happens to that group. Brenda Devlin goes on to say that the 68 cohort, those who were students in Queen's in 1968, become the academics, the teachers, the lawyers, the accountants of the 1970s, the politicians of the 1970s, 80s and 90s. How does that being a Queen's at that particular moment impact on their life? How does it impact on the commitment that they have to particular issues? And that's something that I'm hoping to do. I would like to do a kind of broader oral history study, not just have the kind of same people, the Brenda Devons and the Emma McCanns, but the wider student movement. So if there is anybody here who has been at Queen's in the 1960s and would like to be part of a oral history project, please do contact me. And I'll finish it there. Thank you very much.